difference. So in the previous session, we have discussed about a postal ceiling discriminator. So basically in the discriminator circuit, our input signal is a frequency modulated wave, and in the output we are getting our information, or you can say it is a modulating signal. But we have seen that in a postal ceiling discriminator, as said, that circuit is simple because the primary circuit and the secondary circuit both are tuned at the same frequency, and that is the carrier frequency. But if there will be a kind of a noise, then here in a postal ceiling discriminator, we do not have an amplitude limited circuit. So the output voltage will also, the amplitude of the output voltage will also change with the noise. So here the reset detector circuit is such a that it is a modified version of a postal ceiling discriminator. So here if you see this circuit, then we have an amplitude limited circuit, so that the output voltage will not vary with the noise. So up to certain extent, we can suppress the noise with the help of this ratio detector. So if we compare a postal ceiling discriminator and the ratio detector circuit, the almost the circuit is same, but there are three different things. So here if you see, the primary we have L1C1, secondary L2C2 is there. The same was also in a postal ceiling discriminator. Here this primary is also tuned for a carrier frequency FC, the secondary is also tuned for a carrier frequency FC. Then we have a coupling capacitor, it was also in a postal ceiling discriminator. But now the change in this circuit is, in postal ceiling discriminator D1 and D2 was in the same direction, but now here the polarity of the diode D2 is reversed. In postal ceiling, D2 is connected in this way, but here in a ratio detector, the polarity of the D2 is different. Then due to this polarity, here the voltage across the capacitor C4 is also a reverse. In postal ceiling, this was a negative and this was a positive. But here, now this diode is conducting in this direction. The diode is conducting in this direction. So this potential is positive and this potential is going to be a negative. Then, whatever the extra circuit we have in this case, then there is a resistance R5, R6 and the capacitor C5 is there. Here the capacitor C5, this reactance of this capacitor is very large. So XC is very large, or you can say the value of this capacitor will not be in an order of a picofarad, but it will be in an order of a microfarad. And it is connected across the resistance R5 and R6. Normally the value of R5 and R6 are same. So you can apply the potential divider rule. Then the third change in the circuit is that we are not taking the output voltage between the A dash and B dash. The output voltage is between these two points, that is the O and O dash. Okay. Now, let us see. First of all, we will write what is the expression for the output voltage. The working of the circuit is as it is like a postal ceiling. But here, first of all, we will write what is the expression for a output voltage. Okay. So, here, when this diode D1 will be in a forward bias, then it is going to produce the voltage between the O and A dash. So, let us say this voltage we write as V A dash O. This voltage is V dash O, and the voltage when this diode D2 will be in a forward bias, then it produces the voltage across this capacitor C4, and this voltage is, let us say, VDS0. Remember, this junction is connected to ground. Correct? So, if we write voltage between the point A dash and B dash, then we can write V A dash B dash equal to A V A dash O plus V B dash O. In case of the poster selling, remember, this output voltage was written as a difference of these two voltage. It was a A dash O, V A dash O minus V B dash O. Here we have a summation of these two voltage. Now, this voltage, A dash V dash voltage, is also going to appear across this capacitor. V A dash V dash will be also across this because it is in parallel with the capacitor. So, the same voltage is going to appear. Same voltage is also going to appear across the resistance R5 and R6. So, here, if we say that what is the voltage across the resistance R6, then I can write as VB dash O dash, VB dash O dash. That will be equal to here the R5 and R6. Remember, R5 and R6 both are same. So, half of this voltage you will get. So, if you apply the potential divider rule, then you can write. So, here if I want to write the voltage across the resistance R6, then it is a VB dash O dash equal to a VA dash B dash divided by 2. Correct? Now, what is the output voltage? Output voltage, that is the difference between these two, between this potential and this potential. This is my output voltage. Correct? Now, here remember, this potential is connected to ground and therefore we can write the output voltage is equal to this voltage, that is the V B dash O dash minus this voltage, that is the V B dash O. Correct? Now, what is V B dash O dash? Already we have calculated, it is a V A dash B dash by 2 minus V B dash O. Now, A dash B dash. A dash V dash voltage means it is a summation of V A dash O plus B dash O. So, this is V A dash O plus V B dash O divided by 2 minus V B dash O. And here if you simplify this, then output voltage we can write the as a V A dash plus V B dash O minus 2 V B dash O. So this will be a V A dash O minus V B dash O divided by 2. Remember, so this is the output voltage of a ratio detector. In case of the poster series, the output voltage was given as V dash O minus V B dash O. So here you can see the half of the voltage will be there. In other words, we can say the efficiency of the ratio detector is less than the Forstner-Philips discriminator. Correct? Okay. So, this is regarding how this output voltage you can write for the detector circuit. Now, in a Forstner-Philips, we know that when this input frequency will be equal to a carrier frequency, Fc, Fin is equal to a carrier frequency, and in that case, whatever the voltage is going to be developed across this, correct? And the voltage developed across this, it will be a same. It will be, because it is a center tap transformer, so both the voltage will be same, but they will be in a out of phase. So now here, if we see this output voltage, then the VA dash O and VB dash O will be same, because the same voltage is given to the D1 and the same voltage is also given to the D2. So the voltage A dash O and VB dash O will be also same. Here we can say that first one, when my input frequency is equal to a carried frequency, we can say VD1 will be equal to a VD2. VD1 means what? Voltage across this. And this voltage across this, that is a VD2. Here if I will write, then this is a VD1. And this is the VD2. So both the voltage will be same. As a result, what will happen? That V A dash O will be equal to V B dash O. And here if we use this formula, so the output voltage will be a zero. So when input frequency to the discriminator is a carrier frequency, output voltage will be zero. Here in this case, remember, in this case the phase difference between the primary voltage and the secondary voltage is going to be a 90 degrees. Already we have discussed in case of the Forster series. Now if you see that, suppose the input frequency increase, because in a FM wave the frequency is increasing as well as it is decreasing. So if this FI is greater than your carrier frequency, then if you remember, in that case the phase difference is going to be a greater than 90 degrees. Here, this phase difference is going to be greater than 90 degrees. So in this case, the VD1 voltage across this, means that in the upper part of the circuit the voltage will be a large, in the lower part the voltage will be a less. Here you can say that the VD1 voltage is greater than the VD2 voltage. So it means the voltage across the capacitor C3 will be greater than the voltage across capacitor C4. So this indicates that V A dash O is greater than V B dash O. Correct? And here if we see the output voltage, that is V A dash O minus V B dash O divided by 2, so it will be greater than 0, or you can say the positive voltage will be there. So if the input frequency increases, the output of the discriminator will be positive. The same thing was also happening in a Forster series. Then if we see third one, that input frequency is less than my carrier frequency, then here the VD2 will be large and the VD1 will be a small. VD2 will be greater than VD1. You can say VB dash O is greater than V dash O. So in that case, the voltage across C4 will be larger, and therefore my output voltage, remember, output voltage will be a negative. Here, if you use this formula, in this formula, you can see that if VB dash O is large, then your output voltage will be a negative voltage. So in this way, in a frequency modulated way, frequency will increase, the output voltage of the discriminator will increase, but the frequency will decrease, the output voltage of the discriminator is decreasing. Okay, now we will understand what is the role of this capacitor C5 and why it is known as a ratio detector. Here now try to understand that the capacitor C5, this C5 has a very large reactance. Correct? So XC is very large. So due to this, the capacitor is going to be charged. And that voltage across this capacitor will almost remain constant. Because the XC is large, so the storing capacity is large, so the voltage across this capacitor is going to remain constant. So whatever the voltage across the A dash B dash is there, this capacitor is going to be charged according to the value of A dash B dash. So this voltage here, remember, this voltage is, or you can say VB dash O dash, this voltage is almost remain constant. Correct? Now in this expression, here if you see that VA dash B dash is equal to VA dash O plus VB dash O. Correct? So, here this voltage is remaining across the capacitor C5, so that is a constant. So, VA dash B dash is a constant quantity. And therefore, if we take the summation of VA dash O plus VB dash O, that will be also a constant. But, if we take the ratio VA dash O by VB dash O, this ratio is going to be changed. Summation of both the voltage across the C3 and C4 is always constant. But the voltage across the C3 and C4 is going to change as my frequency is changing. Remember, so suppose if we take an example, that VA dash B dash is equal to a 2 volt. Your input voltage here, V1 2 voltage, is such that it is generating this voltage across the VD1 and the VD2, so that the voltage across this is going to be a 2 volt. And we can write that the 2 is equal to VA dash O plus VB dash O. Now, when this frequency, input frequency is greater than, input frequency is greater than your carrier frequency, then what will happen? The VD1 will be greater than the VD2. It means the V dash O is greater than VB dash O. So let us say this V dash O is a 1.1 volt and VB dash O is a 0.9, because the total here in this case V dash O equal to a VB dash O, and that is equal to a 1 volt. So when the carrier frequency is same, the both the voltage are same, and that is a 1 volt. If the frequency will increase, then the voltage across the diode D1 is increasing, but the voltage across the diode D2 is decreasing. So here if you take this ratio V dash O by VB dash O, this is a 1.1 divided by 0.9. Correct? But the total voltage is remain constant. Now suppose the Fi is less than Fc. Fi is less than Fc, then what will happen? This Vd1 voltage will be less than Vd2 voltage. It means the Va-O will be less than Vb-O. Let us say Va-O is becoming 0.9 and Vb-O becoming 1.11. Because in a D2, the landed voltage is there. So here if you see, then this ratio Va-O by Vb-O will be a Vb-O is 0.9, this is 1.1. But if we take the summation, then this summation will be a 2. So here as the frequency will increase or decrease, but the voltage across the capacitor C5 will remain constant. But whatever the voltage developed across the C3 and C4, if we take this ratio, then the ratio is going to change, and that's why this circuit is known as a ratio detector circuit. Correct? So the most important thing is a capacitor C5, which will try to keep this voltage a constant. Okay, now how this work as an amplitude limiter circuit? Let us see. Now, try to understand this, that whenever the input voltage is there, that already mentioned, that due to that, the capacitor voltage is going to be fully charged and that will produce the voltage A-B-. Correct? Now, suppose there will be some kind of a noise. It is actually with a frequency modulated wave. So, the V12 voltage will increase. Yeah, V12 voltage will increase. So due to this, what will happen? That voltage A-B-' will also try to increase. Because input voltage increase, then naturally the voltage across the capacitor will also try to increase. But here, the reactance of the capacitor is very large, so it will require a larger time period for the charging. It will require a larger time period for the charge, and already it is charged up to a full value. So what will happen due to this? Now Va-O voltage is a constant quantity. Here the voltage across this, remember, again, when this input voltage V12 increase, again we will write this, that this voltage is, let us say, a V1, and this voltage is my Va-O. This voltage is Vb-O. Correct? So we say that when this V12 voltage is going to increase, due to that, the V1 voltage will also increase. V1 voltage will increase, so here the Va-O voltage. Remember, Va-O voltage, or you can say Va-B- voltage, will try to increase, but it will remain constant because we have a larger capacitance. So as a result, what will happen? This potential and this potential is going to increase. Va-B- is constant. You can say Va-O is also a constant quantity. But if we see the difference between these two voltage, that is V1 minus Va-O is going to increase. So the voltage across the anode cathode of the diode is increasing. But But this voltage is remaining constant, so that the current in the diode will increase. So heavy current will flow here, the heavy current. Now remember, the diode D1 and D2 both are in a series. So this current will flow in this way. The current will flow like this due to the both the diodes are in series. So here this current I will increase. So when this difference will increase, so the current I is increasing, or you can say the current in diode is increasing. So due to the increase in the current, there will be an increase in the current in the secondary also, and so the current will increase. In secondary or transformer. So due to this, what will happen? That if the current in the secondary will increase, then there will be a kind of a damping, and due to the damping, the quality factor of this tank circuit will decrease. Remember, so here you can say that due to this, that the damping in transformer increase, you can Q is decreasing. The quality factor of transformer will decrease. If the quality factor of the transformer will decrease, and due to that, whatever the amplifier circuit we have, it is a tune amplifier, remember. Output of the tune amplifier is given to the discriminator circuit. So, the quality factor will decrease, and as a result, the gain of tune amplifier decrease. And the gain will decrease, so the voltage V12 will decrease. So initially, what we have assumed, that suppose there is a kind of a noise, and suddenly the input voltage of the discriminator is increasing. Due to that, the voltage across the tank circuit, that is a V1, will increase, and due to that, here the voltage across the diode D1 will increase, because this voltage is remaining constant. Why this voltage is constant? Because we have a high reactance capacitor, and therefore the VA-SO is remaining constant, but the potential difference across the diode D1 will increase. So there will be a larger flow of the current will be there, and due to the larger flow, you can say the load impedance is decreasing. Here the load impedance decrease. Remember, and load impedance will decrease, so the Q of the secondary transformer will decrease, and that will affect the gain of the amplifier. And already we know that in a tuned amplifier, the gain of the amplifier always depends on the quality factor. So the Q will decrease, then the gain of this amplifier will decrease. So as a result, the voltage V12 will decrease. So in this way, if there will be any variation in the input voltage, then but due to this larger value of the capacitor, your input voltage will try to remain constant. Now the reverse logic also you can apply, that suppose the V12 voltage is decreasing, so the V1 voltage will decrease. V1 voltage will decrease, but VA-VS and VA-SO, this voltage are a constant voltage. These are a constant voltage, so the difference between the anode and cathode of the diode will decrease. So difference will decrease. So the current in the circuit, current in the diode will decrease, and that will increase the load impedance of the secondary. That will increase the load impedance of the secondary, and due to this load impedance, the quality factor Q is increasing. And the Q will increase, then the gain of the amplifier will increase. So your input voltage will also increase. So this is about a ratio detector. How this output voltage, or how this output voltage is remain constant if there will be any variation in the amplitude of a frequency modulated wave. So here, if you see the advantage that it has a amplitude limited circuit because of the resistance R5, R6, and C5. That is, you can say it is introduced to limit the amplitude of the output voltage. Okay? So that is the major advantage of the ratio detector.